Welcome to another edition of Long Beach Treasures. I'm Harvey Keller, your host. Today we're at the Long Beach Municipal Airport, and I have some very special guests with me today. Let me introduce them. This is Barbara London, who is an airport historian, Julie Bartolotto from the Historical Society, Laurel Howitt and her son Andrew, who is also working on her master's thesis using the airport as her thesis work. Welcome, ladies. We're standing in front here of a sign that says Douglas Corrigan. I'm sure that most of you are going to remember him as Wrong Way Corrigan. And I understand, Barbara, you actually knew him.
Yes, I flew with him during World War II. He was a ferry pilot here in the 6th Ferry Group, ferried airplanes with us, and eventually went to work for Douglas as a test pilot before the end of the war.
Interesting story about him, isn't it?
Well, he did a fantastic job in a very, very ill-equipped little airplane, but he made his trip from Long Beach to the East Coast and asked for permission to fly across the ocean like Lindbergh, and they refused because his airplane was not adequate, they said, to make the trip. So he said, fine, I'll go back home. So he filled his airplane up with fuel and headed out, but he headed east instead of west. And his comment for the rest of his life was, I just went the wrong way, but he ended up in Ireland.
So he had to be a tremendous pilot with that little aircraft.
He was an excellent pilot, and his little airplane made it all the way. It was a phenomenal feat.
Laurel, you're doing some research on the airport here. When was it built?
Now, it was completed in 1941, dedicated in 1942.
And if I'm not mistaken, the two architects, W. Horace Austin and Kenneth Wing, two of Long Beach's noted architects.
Right. Actually, Kenneth Wing, who had worked for Horace Austin, did the plans, and even though Horace Austin's name were on them, that was out of respect. Kenneth Wing did most of the work.
Now, any of you can answer my next question. I'm assuming this is in the streamlined modern architectural style, which alluded to the machine age and the movement of ships, planes, and automobiles. Am I correct? Let's look at some of the mosaics, if we can wander down here and look at some of the mosaics that played an important part here at the airport. Right over here. Okay, we're standing here in front of the mosaic, which represents the city of Long Beach. These are designed by Grace Clements. That was part of the Works Progress Administration. Laurel, tell us about the work, tile work, and the mosaics of Grace.
Grace Clements was also, she was paid by the city and the WPA to do this project. It covers two floors in the airport. What you're looking at now is just one part of an entire floor scheme that covered the floor of the main concourse. This here is a traditional seal, but the most of the body of work was in a more abstract design, even though it was for the WPA or the Federal Art Project. And they usually had, the artist did conservative style work. She did rather abstract design of the Western Hemisphere and all the flights and future flights of planes between Long Beach and other points in the world. She also did designs that are now covered, representing oil industry, technology, mariners' navigational tools that included wall murals as well as the floor mosaics.
And there are more mosaics under the carpeting?
Right, it's covered now, but upstairs, when we go up there, I'll show you the floors are the night skies, and those are completely uncovered, and you can get a feeling for what the beautiful colors and patterns she used.
WPA mural. At the beginning of each of our programs, it shows the mural down at the third and the promenade. That's also a WPA mural, and most of the tile there came from the Gladding McBean factory. How about these? Do you know?
Not yet, but I'm going to find out. I know it was assembled in the WPA workshops in downtown Los Angeles and brought here in pieces.
Okay, let's go find another one to look at. Okay, here we are at another one of Grace Clements' beautiful pieces. Tell us about this one, Laurel.
Well, these are seagulls in flight, representing the local color here in Long Beach. She incorporated elements of Long Beach as well as more general topics, like I said, aviation and technology. As I said before, this is part of a huge scheme on the main concourse floor, that most of which is now covered. Hopefully they will restore them and cover them with something that prevents people's shoes from slipping. I think that's the main reason they were covered. They are still in good condition, the parts that are under the carpeting.
It's unfortunate that they have to be covered up because they do give a beautiful elegance to this best-kept secret in Long Beach. Okay, the staircase here looks very Art Deco, and I see another mural there on the landing and also the tiles on the stairs. Are these part of the mural design?
The tiles and the sunrise mosaic are. The poster was not done by Grace Clements. That was put there for decoration. But as you leave the concourse downstairs, you sort of fly up into the sky. You get the feeling up here, and the decoration up here is the night skies and constellations. Grace Clements was a serious astrologist as well, so she put that influence in here and tied it in with the whole airport and flight scheme.
And we're going to have to go to break, so we will be right back in just a few moments, so don't go away, stay tuned.
Long Beach is a town of great diversity. We have more than 100 arts, history, and cultural organizations, and more than 1,000 artists and craftsmen. The Arts and Entertainment Report will keep you informed of the many events, highlights, and changes the arts bring to our great community. Your host, Rob Hankins of the Public Corporation for the Arts, will bring artist interviews, performances, and many programs to help connect families and kids to the arts. Tune in Wednesday through Friday at 7 p.m. only on Charter Channel 3. Want to know the buzz around the LBC? Then watch The Buzz on Charter Channel 3. Hosts Zyda Davis and Jake Boyd will bring you the latest on what's going on around town. They cover movies, restaurant reviews, cool things to do, and fun places to go right here in Long Beach. Also enjoy the short films and skits that take a look at life from a slightly different point of view. The Buzz is a show for young people by young people, and you can see it Monday and Friday at 6:30 p.m. only on Charter Channel 3.
Americans love taking their pets on vacation. Smart planning makes the trip more enjoyable for you and your four-legged traveling companion. The American Veterinary Medical Association says monitoring your pet's condition, proper transport equipment, and vaccinations are essential, especially when traveling from state to state or overseas.
Make sure that they're current on all of their vaccinations. When you put them together with other animals, or in the case perhaps on a camping trip even, that animal is out in the sticks and running around in the parks and things, you really want them to be current on all their vaccinations to prevent them from picking up diseases.
The car is the most important form of pet transportation, but air travel is on the rise. You'll need certified proof of vaccination, food and water dishes in an approved carrier. Before you leave on your trip, the American Veterinary Medical Association says you should check with someone who knows your pet almost as well as you do, your veterinarian.
Charter Communications is your local origination channel. It's the only place where you can see Pep Talk, our longest-running sports talk show. Join hosts John Craig and Jeff Severson as they bring you the best of local and professional sports. Pep Talk is funny, laid back, and sometimes controversial. It's the only sports show on cable where you can call in and express your opinion on current sporting events. You can see Pep Talk on Charter Channel 3, Thursday at 5 p.m. with a replay on Sunday at 7 p.m.
And here we are with Barbara standing in front of her picture when she used to fly. Barbara, tell us a little bit about it.
Well, that's when we were all 21 and invincible and all beautiful. You know, this is during World War II, stationed here at Long Beach, when we were ferrying airplanes from the factories.
Am I correct in that you were the only woman who won the Air Medal during World War II?
The only woman pilot. But that's not because everybody else, others couldn't. It's just the fact that it was made an example of what the women were doing during World War II.
That must have been an interesting time in your life.
Oh, it's fascinating. I mean, where else can a girl who's 21 or 22 have the chance to fly all of these beautiful airplanes?
Did you ever think about becoming a commercial pilot after you left the military?
Oh, I tried right after the war. I applied for all the airlines, but all I got back was an application to become a stewardess, and that really wasn't what I had in mind. So it took many, many years before the airlines were ready to accept the girl.
Were you just ahead of your time?
I guess many years ahead.
That must have been interesting.
It was.
This is another example of Grace Clement's WPA mural work, am I correct?
Her floor mosaic. This is the Compass Rose. We're upstairs now. This is at the entrance to the Propeller Room restaurant, which used to have walls decorated like the night constellations. So you'd fly through the night sky down the hallway, you'd come in contact with this Compass Rose with the signs of the zodiac, and then you could go in. It all flowed together into the restaurant. Barbara can tell us more about the Compass Rose.
Well, we have a Compass Rose out in the middle of the airport, in which you taxi an airplane out and put it on, and that's how we set our compasses in the airplane, by the Compass Rose that's out on the airport. Like this, it doesn't have the zodiac signs on it. It has north, south, east, and west, but it is a Compass Rose.
So this is part of aviation?
It can be marine as well as aviation, yes.
Navigational purposes.
Navigation.
Here we are at the entrance to the prop room, which is the cafe and bar here at the airport, and fine dining. So if you ever want to have a great meal with a great view and something to watch, come on up. Don't go away, stay tuned.
Rock and roll on Channel 3, it will never die. You should watch the house party, let me tell you why.
Rock and Roll House Party is your TV time capsule from the past. Your host, Steve Probst, will take you on a nostalgic trip through the best in rock and roll, doo-wop, and the blues. Also, enjoy rare studio interviews with your favorite stars from this golden age of American music. Tune in Monday at 5:30 p.m. and Friday at 5 p.m. only on Charter Channel 3. Long Beach is a town of great diversity. We have more than 100 arts, history, and cultural organizations, and more than 1,000 artists and craftsmen. The Arts and Entertainment Report will keep you informed of the many events, highlights, and changes the arts bring to our great community. Your host, Rob Hankins of the Public Corporation for the Arts, will bring artist interviews, performances, and many programs to help connect families and kids to the arts. Tune in Wednesday through Friday at 7 p.m. only on Charter Channel 3.
Okay, all of you historians, if I make a mistake, I want you to correct me. I understand Long Beach Airport is the oldest municipal airport in Southern California, preceding LAX by 3 years. Is that correct? And it was founded in 1924 and it reflects the early history of aviation and Earl Daugherty as a colorful aviation pioneer and the father of aviation in Long Beach. Would that be also safe to assume?
Yes, absolutely. He was the originator, and we've been called Daugherty Airport since that.
When did the name change to Long Beach?
It's never really been changed. It's a matter of usage. Well, we call it Long Beach Municipal Airport, but it is considered Daugherty Field.
So his name is still part of Long Beach aviation history?
Part of our legend, yes.
We will be right back in just a few moments, so don't go away, stay tuned.
Watch Inside Long Beach on Charter Communications Channel 3. Join Errol Parker, Randy Gordon, and Mike Murchison as they go inside Long Beach politics, social issues, local events, and more. Inside Long Beach gives you, the people of Long Beach, the opportunity to voice your opinion, ask questions, and interact with leaders from our local government and the community. Tune in Monday and Tuesday at 7 p.m., and the show is live every second and fourth Monday, only on Charter Channel 3.
Killer bees seldom bother people when they're out gathering nectar. However, these Africanized bees defend their nest fiercely, so be safe. Call the experts at 1-800-925-3800 for your local mosquito and vector control district, or call your county agricultural commissioner. If bees attack a person or pet, call 911. We're here to help you.
Be cool about fine safety.
Who are you?
Seymour Smoke. Smoke detector. The more smoke I see, the more noise I make. And I see more smoke coming from that toaster.
Thanks for warning us, Seymour.
That's my job. I hate smoke. It's disgusting. It gives me a headache. So whenever I see it or smell it, I make this noise to warn you. Because where there's smoke, there may be fire.
Good tip, Seymour.
How many smoke detectors do you have in your home? Count them. Is there one outside your bedroom? There should be. Tell your parents.
Be cool about fine safety.
Be cool.
Charter Communications is embarking on an extensive construction project to upgrade your cable system with fiber optic technology. During construction, you may experience temporary interruptions of service. However, not during the evening hours. If you'd like to contact us about the upgrade in your area, call our hotline at 1-877-FIBER-UP. We are working hard deploying this exciting new technology to continue to bring you the cutting edge in entertainment and communication services. To keep you informed, I'll be bringing you updates as this project progresses.
I hope you can hear us. We're outside here of the prop room on the terrace. I'm going to ask Barbara to tell us a little bit about her history in World War II and her flying adventures.
Well, this was a busy airport in 1942 to 45 when the 6th Ferry Group was ferrying all the airplanes built by the factories in the LA Basin. Our airport out here in the middle of the airport was full of airplanes, brand new ones, every night. The next following morning, the pilots of the 6th Ferry Group had to deliver someplace, mostly to points of embarkation like Newark, New Jersey, and to Birmingham, Alabama, and to Great Falls, Montana, where they would go. In Montana, they would go to the Russians. In Newark, they would go to the Eastern Front. We'd bring them back to San Pedro, and they would go to the Pacific. So this was a busy, busy. This was probably the largest ferry group in World War II.
How many years were you involved in the war?
A little over three, from 42 to 45.
The experiences you must have had must have been tremendous.
Oh, it was a fantastic opportunity because with the war on, those of us of the age bracket that we were between 19 and 24 got all the advantages of flying all these beautiful airplanes. We were lacking pilots for World War II, so there was a big training program to get more pilots, and in that they included females, which was very fortunate because to be 21 or 22 years old and be allowed to fly everything that was built in World War II was a tremendous feat, and we really were on the top of the world.
How were you perceived by the male pilots? Did they accept you? Did they think that you had lost your femininity when you put on your outfits to go flying? Or how were you? How did they look upon you?
We were well accepted by the boys, but you see, they were all the same age we were. We were all flying the same airplanes. We were all doing the same job. And we were so busy that nobody had time to worry about whether we were girls or boys. We would come in from a trip one night and go out the following morning and be constantly on the road. That we were well accepted. We were all practically all the same age bracket, all doing the same thing.
How many were in your crew?
The total women pilots was about 1,100, but I had about 80 here at Long Beach, California.
I meant when you were ferrying an aircraft, how many did it take?
Well, fighters only had one seat, so there was just the pilot. Just us.
So you flew alone?
Well, we flew all alone. Yes, there wasn't anybody there.
Well, thank you for joining us today, Barbara. You're a delight.
The airport brings back a lot of memories. This was a very, very strategic airport during World War II, and it continues to be today. This is probably one of the best airports there is in the country.
You know, I wish we had more flights going in and out of here. I know to some this would be an unpopular point of view, but I love flying out of this airport. The only one in the world that I know where I can go and put a quarter in the parking meter to pick up somebody, and that.
Well, this airport has tremendous advantages. Not only is it a good airport from a pilot's point of view, because we have three active runways all the time. We have excellent tower. We have good facilities for instrument approaches. But we have good parking. We have all the things that make an airport. This should be a very busy commercial airport, and it will be someday. We're building on it.
I sure hope so. Again, thank you for joining us today. This is Harvey Keller saying so long. I would like to thank Barbara London, Julie Bartolotto, and Laurel Howitt, and Andrew for joining us today here at the Long Beach Airport. We still think this is one of our best-kept secrets in Long Beach, and maybe someday others will discover what we already know. So join us again next month when we take another tour through history and discover more Long Beach treasures.